Hello, everybody. Welcome. Welcome to Foucault 1313. I know. It was only yesterday. I will be very short. It was only yesterday when we were introducing the series, and now we are not just approaching the end, but rather beginning it. The last seminar Foucault taught at the Collège de France between February 1st and March 28, 1984, is The Courage of Truth, 18 hours of class that he began, like often, complaining about the circumstances of teaching at that institution, with so many people filling not just one but two amphitheatres, a strange cohort of students coming from all over the world and definitely from all over Paris, from unusual places across the Latin neighborhood. Students who were not necessarily actual students and students who were not mainly researchers. He had so many research leads to offer. He was perhaps worried not to being able to establish his own labo de recherche with his own students writing theses and helping him with the Herculean task of research he had charged himself with. You remember the beginning of the book Gilles Deleuze devoted to Foucault 2 years after his death in 1986. Let me quote a bit generously. A new archivist has been appointed. But has anyone actually appointed him? Is he not rather acting on his own instructions? Certain malevolent people say that he is the new representative of a structural technology or technocracy. Others, mistaking their insults for wit, claim that he is a supporter of Hitler, or at least that he offends the rights of man. They will not forgive him for having proclaimed the death of man. Some say that he's a shammer who cannot back himself up with reference to the sacred texts and who seldom quotes the great philosophers. Others, though, claim that something radically new has appeared in philosophy and that this work is as beautiful as those it challenges. It celebrates the dawn of a new age. I read this in French because it's slightly different. D'autres, au contraire, se disent que quelque chose de nouveau, profondément nouveau, est né en philosophie et que cette œuvre a la beauté de ce qu'elle récuse, un matin de fête. In any case, it all begins like a story by Gogol rather than by Kafka. The new archivist proclaims that henceforth he will deal only with statements. He will not concern himself with what previous archivists have treated in a thousand different ways, propositions and phrases. He will ignore both the vertical hierarchy of propositions which are stacked on top of one another and the horizontal relationship established between phrases in which each seems to respond to another. Instead, he will remain mobile, skimming along in a kind of diagonal line that allows him to read what could not be apprehended before. And you see in this text, Deleuze speaks of Foucault as if the latter were still alive, as if he had just been appointed himself a new archivist. But we don't want to turn this last session into some sort of obituary. On the contrary, in these 18 hours, Foucault continues his project on the government of the self and others by performing a series of transformations or changes that Bernard has beautifully explained in his introduction, from risk to courage on the one hand, and from political to ethical paresia on the other. In this series, Foucault engages in a new analysis of the cynics and of cynic philosophy, an analysis that is so relevant for the current political situation in many places, including Spain, or the different iterations of that call from Stéphane Hessel, Indignez-vous. We will be discussing all that, but before I introduce our guests for today, I would like to engage in something very necessary. It is not a secret that we are now reaching the end of this year-long seminar and that it could have not been possible without the concourse of many collaborators, and we would like to thank them. The Columbia Center for Contemporary Critical Thought, and especially Claire Merrill and Elise Wang, the Society of Fellows, and Eileen Glulli and Conley Lawrence in particular, the Maison Française with Shani Pierre and Joella Jones, the Hispanic Institute for Latin American and Iberian Cultures, the Provost and Executive Vice President of Arts and Sciences, Miguel Ripoll for the design, Alex Hill for the website, Robert, Joe, and John at Total Webcasting, and our four graduate students who have had the generosity to work with us, Ibai Atucha, Rafael Burns, Agnese Codebo, and Luca Provenzano. Without the participation of these four outstanding graduate students, nothing would have been possible. And I personally want to thank Bernard, and you know why. We also want to thank all the guests we have had the chance to think with this during these 13 sessions, and of course, all of you. All those who have accompanied us during this fascinating trip across Foucault's seminars at the Collège de France. Now, I am going to introduce our guests for today, although they are so well known, they probably don't need an introduction. Frédéric Gros, who is a professor of political thought at Sciences Po, Paris, and Paris. He is the editor of several of Michel Foucault's lectures at the Collège de France, Subjectivité, Vérité, L'Herméneutique du Sujet, Le Gouvernement de Soi et des Autres, Le Courage de la Vérité, à l'échéance. And he is the chief editor of Foucault's complete works in La Pléiade. His research interests include French contemporary philosophy, the foundation of the right to punish, war and security, and the ethics of the political subject, namely through the problem of obedience and disobedience. He is the author of Michel Foucault, Foucault et la folie, État des violences, Essai sur la fin de la guerre, Marché, une philosophie, Le principe sécurité. Then we have Suleiman Bachir Diagne, alumnus of the École Normale Supérieure. He received his doctorat d'état in philosophy at the Sorbonne. Before joining Columbia University in 2008, he taught philosophy for many years at Sheikh Anta Diop University, Dakar, au Senegal, and at Northwestern University. His field of research includes history of logic, history of philosophy, Islamic philosophy, African philosophy and literature, and translation. His book, Berson Postcolonial, L'élan vital dans la pensée des Senghor et de Mohamed Iqbal, was awarded the Daniel Bouveret Prize for the French Academy of Moral and Political Sciences in 2011. And on that same year, he received the Édouard Glissant Prize for his work. He is the author of L'encre des savants, Réflexion sur la philosophie en Afrique, Comment philosopher en Islam, African Art as Philosophy, Senghor, Berson, and the Idea of Negritude, and Fidelity and Movement in the Philosophy of Muhammad Iqbal. Gayatri Spivak is Spivak, university professor and founding member of the Institute for Comparative Literature and Society. Her fields of study span from the 19th and 20th century literature, politics of culture, feminism, Marx and Derrida, to globalization. Her most recent publication include the 2016 40th anniversary edition of Jacques Derrida's Of Grammatology, Readings, and Anesthetic Education in the Age of Globalization. Spivak has written numerous books and articles, including In Other Worlds, Essays in Cultural Politics, Thinking at Academic Freedom in Gendered Postcoloniality, Outside in the Teaching Machine, Imperatives to Reimagine the Planet, A Critique of Postcolonial Reason Towards the History of the Vanishing Present, Death of a Discipline, and Other Asias. She has translated and introduced several texts by Mahashweta Devi and Ramprasad Sen. Her book, Du Bois and the General Strike, is forthcoming. Spivak has been an activist in rural education and feminist and ecological social movements since 1986. Then, Bernard Harcourt will make some final remarks and will ask some questions before opening the discussion to the public. Please help join me in welcoming our guests.
Frédéric. Thanks for your invitation, yes.
And I'm very happy to be here with you.
So I would like to present you a text about the problem of truth in Michel Foucault's work. I think that this problem of truth is both central and complicated in Michel Foucault's work. And I apologize in advance for what will inevitably be a schematic treatment of the subject today. The concept of truth is particularly present in Foucault's final lectures at the Collège de France, for example, in his analysis of Socrates' death and of the cynics. The question I would like to put to this text, to these lectures of 1984, and perhaps more generally to the work of Foucault, is what would be, what is the relationship between truth and obedience, and between truth and disobedience? On the one hand, Foucault espouses the idea that truth is an expression, a testimony, a témoignage, a testimony to disobedience. Truth is on the side of rebellion, of resistance, of what Foucault called, for example, the uprising, le soulèvement, the uprising of subjects. And there are two elements in this claim. First, truth is a weapon. And second, the very movement of resistance expresses a certain kind of truth. So truth is resistance. On the other hand, Foucault expresses completely contrary vision of truth. Namely, the truth produces obedience. Truth is a way of obtaining our obedience, and discourses of truth are instruments of submission. And I think that we can find in Michel Foucault's work a tension and maybe even a contradiction at the heart of Foucault's definition of truth that allows these two statements. First, truth is what makes us obey, and truth paves the way for disobedience. So this leads us to ask, is it possible to speak of truth in both cases? And if so, what is the common thread running through these two contradictory definitions of truth? So I don't have a definitive answer to this question, but I'd like to distinguish here two types of truth: obedient truths and disobedient truth. So in the late Foucault, in the Foucault's lectures at the Collège de France in 1982, 3 and 4. Before turning to Foucault's later work on the Greeks, I would like to return to his first major project during the 60s and 70s on the archaeology and genealogy of social sciences. Foucault's critique of the social sciences presumes that there is a distinction between what I will call normative and irreducible truths. It's the first opposition for me between normative truths and irreducible truths. During the 70s, Foucault develops the concept of the norm, which he defines as a schema of behavior inculcated by certain institutions such as the school, the factory, and the army. It is a model attitude that the individual must adopt, or else he will face punishment. The social sciences, according to Foucault, ranging from psychology to criminology, validate this norm in the interior of a particular discourse of truth. Thus, if discipline produces normality in individual behavior, the social sciences establish that normality as the truth of individual behavior. Nonetheless, Foucault does not consider the social sciences as false or mere ideologies. This is the point important for me. They are really true, if not truly true. I think that we can make a difference between what is really true and what is truly true. Social sciences do not lie. They stamped truth on the reality produced by power. But this attempt to normalize existence can also provoke a backlash in the form of resistance. This singular reality of particular subjects rebels, and in its rebellion produces a counter-truth. I mean a testimony to the impossibility of reducing life to a norm. And for example, it is the truth expressed in the memoir of Pierre Rivière, in the text of Pierre Rivière, who confronts the questions of judges and psychiatrists. It is the truth expressed in the battle of the hysterics against Charcot's project of neurological codification. During the 70s, I think Foucault historically traces the formation of disciplinary truths in the modern West and concentrates on their political and economic function. It becomes clear that these disciplinary truths are in service of the state that seeks to control its population and guarantee public order, or that these truths are subordinated to the capitalist economy that aims only to extract the maximum utility out of each and every body. I put the name of transgression when I want to designate this type of disobedience in the first system of the 70s. Starting in the 80s and Foucault's study of ancient schools of wisdom, I think he will begin to focus on truths of resistance. His lectures of 1984 expose three central oppositions, of which the first two had already been developed in his previous lectures. The first of these oppositions, already present in L'Herméneutique du Sujet in 1982, is between what we could call experts' truth and ethical truth. But it is a reconstruction of Foucault. It is not a description. You mean I try to make this large reconstruction, but it's not possible to find exactly these terms in Foucault's work. It's a reconstruction. So what I call experts' truth are elements of knowledge, demonstrated, established, erudite truth, and in order to acquire these truths, the subject does not need to work on itself ethically, and the successful acquisition does not change the subject's relationship to itself or to the world. I mean, what I call experts' truth provide social prestige, but do not add to the subject's spiritual substance. Mm-hmm. These scholarly, specialized and scientific truths allow us to differentiate between a knowledgeable elite and the ignorant masses. So what I call experts' truth help stratify society by introducing hierarchy into it. In contrast, ethical truths transform our relationships to ourselves. We interiorize them progressively using techniques of the self, what Foucault calls les techniques de soi, les techniques, les pratiques de subjectivation. And they provide the material for what Foucault calls techniques of subjectification. These ethical truths feed and maintain the care of the self. The care of the self, needless to say, should not be understood as the expression of complacency, dandyism, or of an egotistical withdrawal. The care of the self is essentially an attitude by which we render ourselves present to our own selves. To become present to oneself is to refuse to be swept up in the flakes of life, to refuse to live automatically. One becomes present to oneself in order to respond to the solicitations of others and of the world, in order to live up to events, not by relying upon ready-made or learned answers, but by rallying on one's own foundations. It is that there's an act of responsibility. I think that what Foucault calls le souci de soi is it's a manner of considering responsibility. So it's an act of responsibility, le souci de soi, by which we answer the call of others and the world from within oneself, but from within a substantial reflective self. The care of the self, thus, it is a form of resistance, of ethical resistance, that allows a type of disobedience. So it's what I call resistance, and it's not the same thing than transgression. I think there is a third opposition, and we can find it in Le Courage de la Vérité, but in Le Gouvernement de Soi et des Autres aussi, when Foucault studies the Greek concept of paresia, which, you know, he will return to in 1984. It is what I call it's a new opposition for me. It's what I call the opposition between dominant truth and dissident truth. Dominant truth is the truth of the majority, of public opinion. And one could even call it democratic truth. And the sense that it is the truth that everybody recognizes and accepts. It's a democratic truth. Dominant truth or democratic truth is thus an expression of consensus. It expresses what a political body at a particular time considers just, reasonable, and legitimate. There is, I think, another element. Dominant truth is what the majority wants to hear, what comforts them in their certainty. Therefore, it relies upon an agreement. This agreement can be the product of rational deliberation, but it can also be the result of cowardice, flattery, and laziness. So it is the truth, dominant truth, it is the truth that is recognized by everyone else, but is thought through by no one in particular. So, in contrast, what the Greeks call paresia is the precise opposite of dominant truth. On connaît la scène, hein? We know the scene. An individual publicly announces a truth that disturbs, worries, and shatters consensus. So, inevitably, this truth, the truth of paresia, produces disharmony, when it is precisely what we would rather hide from ourselves and from others. So we see in paresia, we have, it's the courage of truth, the courage to state truths that displease the majority, no matter the cost. It is thus a truth that produces difference. The parrhesia introduces dissonance into the consensus, and the dissonance forces each of us to listen to something he would rather not hear, to come face to face with something he would rather hide from himself. And I think it is a third type of disobedience. I think parrhesia allows us to imagine a dissident type of disobedience, what we could even call civic dissidence. And it's not the same thing than the disobedience civil disobedience. Civic dissidence, it's other dimension of disobedience. And civic dissidence announces a truth that ruptures the consensus founded on public truth that we accept because it allows us to cower in the truth of everybody else. So now the lectures of 1984 take up, I think, and we orchestrate these two oppositions between expert truths and ethical truths, and between dominant truth and dissident truth, through the study of asceticism, and the cynical parrhesia. Moreover, the introduction of the true life, the problem of what is true life, the introduction of the true life in the study of the cynics allows us to introduce a final opposition between what I will call essential truth and elementary truth. Essential truth, la vérité essentielle, et la vérité élémentaire. Essential truths are those that metaphysics tries to discover and formulate. The goal is to uncover by means of thought the small number of truths that resist doubt, resist time, resist contestation. The truths that are simultaneously rational, universal, eternal, and definitive. We search for them through discourse, demonstration, and rational argumentation. Essential truth is therefore a challenge that philosophy addresses to thought and to language. Essential truth founds the identity of each thing and allows each thing to remain identical to itself. And it is thus that Platonic philosophy aims to pierce the fog of opinion in order to reach these pure, ideal, and essential truths by way of thought, because they alone can provide the grounding for rational government of the city. So, essential truth purifies thought. It is the mirror of thought, and thought is its reflection. Essential truths produce similitude, identity, and conformity. So it's the destiny of philosophy, of Western philosophy, to discover essential truths. But philosophy addresses another challenge, this time to life itself. And it is the cynics who represent this immense and derisory project. The challenge is to discover the small number of elementary things that we really need in order to live and to rid existence of all the rest. In order to do so, we must surpass, ignore, and disdain social conventions and manners. And I think what Foucault calls the true life is the existence that is free of everything accessories, secondary and useless, freed from social conventions and historical codes. So a life stripped down to its purest, simplest elements. I think this cynical movement strips existence of its veneer, rids it of hypocritical conventions and social artifice, in order to rediscover the very root of life, the elementary truths we need that make us live and our sorts of energy. Again, this cynical scraping is a form of disobedience that we could call, that I call subversion. And it's for me another type of disobedience, what I call subversion. The cynics practice what we could call a passage to the brink, a passage à la limite, passage to the brink. They exaggerate the need for purity, the need for nature and truth, the need for truth. They exaggerate this to the point that their life becomes filthy, infamous, scandalous. They disobey codes, they ignore conventions, they despise social hierarchy and political power out of faithfulness to the elementary truths of life and the body. So, elementary truth therefore produces otherness. The true life of the cynics is a provocation whose goal is to worry and disturb complacency and social certitudes. This brings us to an important point. I think we can find in Foucault's work the idea of two regimes of truth. The first regime of truth demands us to accept the reality of the world and social hierarchies. The discourses of the social sciences normalize individual behavior. Experts' truth introduce hierarchies into society. Consented truths dominate public discourse, and essential truths oblige thought itself. Each of these engenders a form of obedience. But I think there is a second regime of truth which opposes norms with the intensity of individual lives. This regime uses the subject as the very source of resistance and disobedience. And I think this opposition between what I call obedient truths and disobedient truths, this opposition leaves us with a legitimate question that Foucault recognizes but does not pose, namely, because we speak, you speak of disciplinary truth produced by the social sciences. You speak of consented truths that dominate public discourse, erudite or essential truth that philosophy and science construct. And you say that these truths teach us to obey. But are these truths truly true? In the same vein, on what basis can we call irreducible, ethical, paresiastic, and elementary truths true? I think this question, the question of the truth of truth, is that of the epistemological analysis of truth, and Foucault doesn't pose it. This question of the truth of truth presupposes that the contrary of truth is error, illusion, ideology, lies, or fiction. But, and this is my conclusion, when Foucault writes, when he writes his political history of truth, he is not basing his work on the opposition between truth and error. Instead, he traces the eternal fight between the truth that leads us to accept reality and those that push us to transform ourselves and the world, between the truth that teaches us to obey and those that allow us to disobey. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and I will start by apologizing for having mixed up 6:15, which is a very strange time, and 6:30. This is the reason why I came a little bit late. But hopefully you were not waiting for me.
We were not waiting for you.
Okay, thank you for saying that.
We were just waiting for you.
That's a very, that was a very nice lie. And I wanted to thank you also, to thank you and Bernard for having invited me to be part of this Foucault 1313, especially on a panel with Frederic Gros and Gayatri D. So thank you very much. Very generally, the lectures collected under this title, Le Courage de la Vérité, delivered in 1984, are about paresia, as Frédéric has shown. Paresia defined as le tout dire, this is a phrase that Foucault uses, saying it all, saying it as it is, or le franc parler, straight talk, I guess would be the good translation for le franc-parler. Le courage de la vérité would be then the courage of saying the truth, knowing that there is a risk in doing so. And Foucault insists on the fact that there is no paresia where there is no conscience of the risk. And this is not just the risk in expressing dissent and being in dissidence when there is an established truth that one speaks against. I guess if I use your terminology, that one could say that you cannot have paresia when the whole point is about an expert's truth. In other words, Galileo Galilei is not speaking paresia, and he was absolutely right, actually, recanting his theory in front of the Inquisition. If they say, oh, it is not so, it doesn't move, he was absolutely right saying, I agree, it doesn't move, because he is not really engaged in that truth ethically, as you put it. And I'm drawing that from Albert Camus, who also wrote that Galileo was absolutely right recanting that kind of expert truth. The kind of truth that make us speak about paresia is something different. The other risk is probably even more important, the risk of hurting. And this is a very important point of paresia. If I don't want to hurt people, I still have to be a paresiast for those people and speak the truth, because as you have said and explained, it is about transforming myself and transforming the word as well. So paresia, saying it all, and at the same time accepting the risk of hurting or angering, and therefore putting oneself in dangers. So these lectures revolve around the figure of the paresiast par excellence, the one who gives her opinion. I'm here quoting Foucault, the one who gives her opinion and attaches his signature to the truth he enunciates and is obligated by it. And I guess this corresponds also to what you have mentioned as the act of responsibility. And at that point, quoting Aristotle, Foucault makes it clear that paresia is a sign of being, of megalopsychia, which is translated in Sanskrit, I guess, as Mahatma. I'm speaking under the control of Gayatri D. So the second part of the volume, the lectures given are the lectures Foucault gave at the end of February of 1984 and during the month of March. I am focused, and in those lectures, the figure of the parisiaste par excellence, who is the cynic, is at the center. And the cynics, as we know, say all these two in their own cynical way, which is different from Socratic irony way. One could say that the cynics actually has pushed Socratic irony to the point of madness even. And here, saying madness, I'm quoting Plato, who thought that Diogenes was a kind of mad Socrates. But I'm more interested in the first half of the volume, which is about Socrates. And I would just raise 4 points in that first part. First point, prophets may have been killed oftentimes for having brought an unwanted truth, but by the very definition of what the parasiast is, prophets cannot be parasiast. So killing prophets because you don't want the truth that they are bringing doesn't make them parasiast who have taken the risk of a truth to which they have attached their own signature and to which they feel obligated, because they are just the vessel, the vehicle of a truth to which they had access from the other world, thanks to mnemosyne, memory, and they present themselves as having brought aletheia, truth, from forgetfulness, lete, to remind here the way in which Foucault opposes aletheia to lete in his book. But they are very different from the figure of the philosopher, and they are very different from the figure of the parasiast, again, because they have not attached their signature to the truth stated. And I believe that here, when Foucault makes the difference between the parasiast and all kind of people who are speaking the truth on behalf because they are inspired by another word, another reality, Aletheia has spoken to them directly. We should have in mind here a book that was very important at the time, and is still very important, Marcel Detienne's book on Les Maîtres de Vérité dans la Grèce Archaïque, published in 1967, in which Marcel Detienne mentioned that the master of truth is the contrary of the philosopher, because philosophy and seeking a truth that you are then responsible for has nothing to do with being the master of truth who speaks the truth, because the truth has been inspired to them. So unlike the master of truth, the parasiast is a servant of truth. And I believe that this distinction between master of truth and servant of truth, again, I'm introducing, like you did, my own vocabulary into Foucault's text, would be a useful way of looking at his cours of the year 1984, and could be a point to be discussed. Second point, the blurb of the book, and I believe it has not been translated yet into English.
It has.
Oh, okay.
I just did.
You just...
No, no, I'm kidding.
Okay. The blurb reminds us that Courage de la Vérité is actually the collection of the last lectures as Foucault died just 3 months after having given these lectures. We may not need to over-dramatize the fact by retro-projecting, so to say, upon the lectures, the imminent death of Foucault, and you mentioned that we should not be turning this session into some form of obituary. And the truth of the lectures are in the lectures themselves and not in the event of Foucault's death 3 months after. But still, we should note the fact that one lesson to be drawn from these lectures is that Foucault is here going back to a scene in which the meaning of philosophy can be said to be concentrated, and that scene is the death of Socrates. And he is coming back to this notion that to philosophize is to learn how to die, as Montaigne famously said, quoting Cicero. Or rather, to learn not to fear death, which is to learn how to live. In the end, le souci de soi and the government of the self, le gouvernement de soi, would mean that the practice of philosophy is about the true life, the aletheis bios, which as such is beyond the reach of death. Reminding us, in other words, in these last lectures, that in the end and at the beginning, philosophy is not a way of thinking or knowing, but primarily a way of living. It is because philosophy is a way of living and not about being smart on questions that it is subsequently a way of thinking and a way of knowing, which leads me to my third point about aletheis bios, true life, as force of living. And the point I want to emphasize here is that Foucault is somehow taking the defense of Socrates and Platonism against Nietzsche. I think that this point is very important because he was writing, he was giving these lectures at a time, 1984, where this very Nietzschean idea that Plato is a philosopher of death, this life is worthless, only the other life is the true life, etc., and that he was denounced by Nietzsche about that, was monnaie courante. This is where the philosophical scene was. Nietzsche, as we know, presents Socrates as the enemy of life, and he considers him the figure of the negation of life, and this is something we can find in Nietzsche's Gay Science or the genealogy of morals. And we have to think that at that time, I mean, what I described as the intellectual scene at the time was very much shaped by the work of Gilles Deleuze on Nietzsche, both his Nietzsche et la philosophie, 1962, and Nietzsche, sa vie, son œuvre, et sa philosophie, l'exposé de sa philosophie, 1965. Where the point was that starting with Socrates, philosophy has become a way of thinking opposed to life in rupture with what was the case with the pre-Socratics. And against this accusation, Foucault in his lectures, in his close reading of the Apology, Crito, Phaedo, rehabilitates Socrates and explains differently from Nietzsche the famous mysterious words pronounced by Socrates when he asked Crito to pay a debt, saying, "We owe a cup to Asclepius, do pay it, don't forget," insisting on not forgetting this. And as we know, for Nietzsche, this was an aha moment. The reason why Socrates felt indebted to the god of healing, Asclepius, was that he felt that he was being healed from life itself, and that the disease in question that he had was just to have been living. And Nietzsche considered this the sign that Platonism is against the vitalist affirmation of life. And what Foucault is saying here, and this is very important at the time again, is that on the contrary, the final moments of Socrates when he welcomes death are a hymn to life, an affirmation of the force of living, and living a true life, which means a life which is out of the reach of death, a life placed under the auspices of le souci de soi, taking care of oneself. And this brings me to my fourth and last point. The first and final word of philosophy as a way of living, before it is a way of knowing, is then take care of yourself. And le courage de la vérité is also the courage to live such a full and true life that one is able to stare at one's death the way Socrates did. And when I mention staring at one's death, I have here in mind also the book of Irving Yalom, Staring at the Sun, in which he explains that there are two things that we cannot stare at precisely, the sun and our own death. So you want to say, well, Socrates did. I don't know about the sun, but about death, he did stare at it. So if le courage de la vérité, the courage to live truth, is to constitute myself, this is another added meaning, to constitute myself as a subject capable of truth, then that life of mine is out of reach of death. And this is that what Foucault says afterwards in the second part, apropos the cynics about true life, applies here to Socrates as well, when he says that true life is not only the choice of a different life, sovereign and happy, but also the practice of a combativeness that opens up the horizon of another world. And I believe that this is true for Socrates as well. His death has nothing to do with any kind of resignation or the idea that the afterlife is better than this life, which is absolutely meaningless, and anyway, my soul is immortal, so I'm not losing anything. But it is an affirmation of the type of combativeness that is about opening up the horizon for another world, transforming myself in order to transform the world, as Frederick said earlier. So the words of Socrates, and I believe this is a lesson to be drawn for the close reading of these three dialogues, Platonic dialogues that Foucault conducts here, is that his last words are not a testament at all. If we consider that a testament would still be a way of prolonging oneself, of considering that there are things that are incomplete in the life one has led, and therefore you need to have in writing or to declare to your disciples some things that need to be done after you have departed, things that you consider are incomplete and you ask them to complete, that would be a testament. But Socrates doesn't say anything such like that. He doesn't ask those who stay, his disciples, to complete what has not been completed by him. And that is so much the case that even for his children, when Crito, who absolutely loves Socrates, of course, and insists that Socrates leave them with some task to do, something to do for him. Well, if not for you, he was the one who proposed his evasion. And if we do not do it for you, what do you want us to do for your children? One could think that, obviously, if you know you are going to die because you have already drank the hemlock, you would like your friends to take care of your children, make sure that they go to Columbia for college, stuff like that. But Socrates just dismisses the question, not because he is not caring, but precisely because the message in the face of death must remain the same as it always has been. For the bios aletes to be truly aletes, he has to consider that the message was complete. Death is going always to find someone in the middle of something. Usually, well, it happens in novels, but the idea of having completed everything, being on your bed, surrounded by your great-grandchildren, and saying, now it is time to go, I have done everything, that doesn't happen. You leave children behind, as Socrates did. But still, the children who represent the continuation of life are not the continuation of his life. He's not asking for any kind of overtime by writing or dictating a testament. He's saying that everything is complete as long as you understand that the message has always been, take care of yourself. And in that case, my children as well are going to live their lives, which means they are going to take care of themselves. Humon auton epi melumenoi. And this is a lesson. I believe that Foucault, by defending Socrates and Plato against Nietzsche, gave us a great lesson in this lecture. The lesson that his philosophy is not about death, is not about the other world, about the ideal world, turning your back to this world of shadows, etc. But the lesson according to which philosophy is about the force of life. And I believe that in that sense, Spinoza is a heir, speaking of Testament, is a heir of that Socrates of the affirmation of the force of living, when he says that it is not just about knowing that the soul is immortal and therefore I am going to my soul is going to continue even if my body is left to this world of generation and decay, but on the contrary, experimenting while you are living the aletheus vios, that we do live, we do feel and experiment that our life is a life sub quadam specie aeternitatis, under a certain form of eternity. So thank you and take care of yourselves.
I am speaking into the mic, right? I have a very loud voice anyway. Thank you very much, Bernard and Jesus, for having invited me to do this. I don't know that much about Foucault, but this made me really, as you know, through the months, this really made me think of many different kinds of projects that one could do because of the way Foucault is giving these lectures, including, and I'm not going to touch on this at all, but you know that I sent you this stuff, which is Greek polytheism, which is a very different kind of thing. It's not just a division of labor like the way Foucault is going, a cock to Asclepius. Now, it's not just, how does it coexist with this kind of philosophy? That's a question I'm not going to hit on, but I sent you stuff which where this question has to be thought through, because there are also in this text places where the word gods in Greek is translated God. And that's something that one has to think about. It's such a subtext that I'll never get to it. But and don't even ask me any questions about it. So let me say that this is certainly not an obituary. And this is not a retroprojection. I'm a literary critic, and I'm 74 years old, so, and this is not without importance. I have very recently been talking about the constitutive disability of the subject of democracy. That, you know, you think about the democratic subject as normal, but if you begin to think from 18 to death, and especially with all these 100-year-old people here, you have to really think about the democratic subject differently. And therefore, what this is an elegy. What this is an elegy, which is a very different kind of thing, where you, in fact, think about how this will live. So therefore, I'm not turning my back on the fact at all that these are the last lectures. I don't think there is a concept of truth here at all. Although, Frédéric, I think your way of looking at all of Foucault is fantastic and very helpful, and it will help me, but then I am not really a Foucauldian, and I'm looking at these lectures. And here, if one is, I mean, he in fact goes with Aletheia, and there is a footnote, I think I made a note of it, 219, where he, because I keep on looking at this, and I'm thinking, where is adequatio? That's the other big one. It's not just forgetting, but it's also being adequate. Why is he, he knows. But on the note in the English page 219, you can see he makes a note about it, he cuts it out. Then he says again the stuff about, see what I mean? He talks about it cannot take a supplement. There's no concept of truth here, for me at least. There are figures of truth. Because if there were concept of truth in this, it would be reactionary and extremely simplistic. Whereas, simplistic. You know, I mean, there's this there's this sociological stuff, you know, register of exactitude, and there's this other stuff, register of truth. Come on. This is not so, to an extent, it seems to me that also this kind of totally intentionalist subject, I think this thing is a staging of something. I think these last lectures are a staging of something, so that this incredible, and I'll come to it at the end, I don't think Foucault is talking about himself. I think he's staging a certain kind of complete intention. Otherwise, think about what Foucault went through and what all of that thinking was, that one can say that truth is identical with itself. Give me a break here. I mean, this is something that is being staged in a certain way, and I want to read it in the elegiac mode. And Frédéric, I should also say that I totally agree with you that he did not, in fact, look at the epistemological. But in this set of lectures, epistemology cannot be thought about. Because we must assume that there is a mind, there is subject, there are people who can do things in certain ways, choose this, choose that. It's a theater. And so to an extent, although I will at a certain point break this and say that one can take it into an epistemological project, because I want not to accuse, not to excuse, inhabit a little space and turn it around. If I can drop a name, I mean, you know, I am an old person. Foucault didn't come to my Mallarmé lecture by telling Jean Vance that I was a petite derridiste. And I want there to show that a petit derridiste, if they take the Derridian formula of not accusing, not excusing, but finding intimately a moment in the text and turning it around, it'll be in the interest of the epistemological project. That can't be here. So anyway, I was thinking also, now I'm not a young person, as I told you, and so therefore I don't make late nights because I'm still working full time. And therefore, I have missed a lot of the discussions. And obviously, like everybody else, sometimes I couldn't come. So it is quite possible that you have spoken about Edward Said. But if you haven't spoken about Edward Said, this is the very last talk. Edward has been on my mind because I've been reading Foucault, and Diman in 1974 showed me Edward right at the back of Naples Pizza. And Edward was in 1974. The man was so beautiful, you can't believe. And, you know, he's sitting there in a very sort of melancholy way like this. And the man says to me, "Do you know this man?" I said, "No." And I'm saying to myself, I'd love to know this man. So, and he says, "You should. He's working on Foucault." So to an extent, I felt very much Edward's presence. So I would like to begin, since he certainly knew the elegiac mode, I would like to begin with Said's On Late Style. And he certainly tells us why we should not run away from elegies and not mistake them for obituaries or retro-projecting. I quote, "The relationship between bodily condition and aesthetic style seems at first to be a subject so irrelevant, as we discussed, and perhaps even trivial, by comparison with the momentousness of life, mortality, medical science, and health, as to be quickly dismissed. Nevertheless," and this is almost saying what Foucault is saying, except in a completely different kind of language, "my contention is as follows. All of us, by virtue of the simple fact of being conscious, are involved in constantly thinking about and making something of our lives, self-making being one of the bases of history, which, according to Ibn Khaldun and Vicot, the great founders of the science of history, is essentially the product of human labor." Exactly like Foucault, right? On the other hand, I'm saying here, Said has clearly oublié Foucault. You remember the mischievous title of the book by Jean Maudrillard, And Baudrillard, exactly, because this is clearly Foucault, and Said knew his Foucault. But why? Perhaps because there was so much storm and drang over his misunderstanding of Foucault, first from Jim Clifford and others, and lately the question from our friend Etienne Balibar, and I quote, "Did Said have any acquaintance, direct or indirect, with the discourses in which, through the detour of a discussion of the Greek notion of paresia, Foucault himself tried to engage in a genealogy of the agonistic relationship between, quote, truth-telling as a function of the intellectual and the combination of power and knowledge in the exercise of government?" Balibar asks about Edward. Probably not. But for us, at least, the result is a striking tension between the clear Foucauldian resonances of those words with which Said defines what he calls, and I quote, Balibar quoting Said, "the basic question for the intellectual. How does one speak the truth? What truth? For whom and where?" And a certain distance which is perceptible in the text with respect to Foucault's understanding and applications of his own formulations. "With a few others," he writes, "I do in fact believe that a self-critical reflection of Foucault's on his own engagement alongside the Iranian Revolution, about which he kept completely silent after 1979, could be one of the causes of Foucault's interest for the meaning and transformations of the ancient civic and moral notion of the paresia, or the fearless speech," end of quote. Foucault himself, as you know, relates German interest in cynicism to the Second World War. So Said isn't, Etienne Balibar is not doing something which is not within Foucault's text. On the other hand, I would say that if one looks at this as a staged stage performance of figures of truth, then one realizes that one should think about Said and his idea of the late style. And also, I would say, right at the beginning, I mean, the style of these essays, again and again, promises made, promises uttered, promises broken, and a very peculiar kind of technique, that is, anecdote after anecdote being read. It's almost like a narrative as ethical instantiation rather than argument. So that to an extent, we have to look at this in this other kind of way. Right at the beginning, he says that he likes very much the idea of two people as he comes into these thinkings. That disappears. But I would like to say, even as I think that what Frédéric was talking about in terms of contradiction, two regimes, Foucault's word is the paradox in these lectures, right? That paradox is contained in the cynics. And to an extent, what happens with the cynics is Foucault and these figures who are named, about whom anecdotes are told, they begin to share that kind of two-ness. Remember, he was interested in the second person. That's what really made him very... are people actually leaving? Very sad. But at any rate, you know, I'm sorry, I shouldn't say this is very bad form, but on the other hand, I'm so intellectually insecure, and then I see people kind of leaving, and I just kind of fade away. So forget all this, okay? Let's just go. So for him, another, quote, cause, if that is the word, is the call of late style. What is Said's definition of late style? His, quote, obvious personal reason, Said's, is impending death from chronic leukemia. This is a quotation of his in his text. "I'm also now revising my words on Franz Fanon." By the way, Foucault was 1 year younger than Fanon. Eh? One forgets how close, and he, of course, was in Tunisia right after, etc. One forgets. The Franz Fanon opening Olson's film concerning violence, and therefore thinking hard about the fact that The Wretched of the Earth was famously written in the last 10 weeks of Fanon's life. Last 10 weeks of Fanon's life, when he knew he was dying of acute leukemia and finally traveling to a hostile United States for a cure that failed. Said suggests that at a certain point in our lives, we want to locate a point of origin, but the late style does not necessarily do so. I would like to propose that Foucault does the whole thing in these last lectures. Socrates began, but also didn't begin. And then he does a Vedi Napoli Poi Mori. He says, a philosophy professor must teach Socrates at least once in one's life, pays his dues, goes into the cynics. So the Socrates stuff is also staged. I got to do it, man. I can't not teach Socrates. Said's second great problematic, and I quote, is about continuity. This too Foucault rehearses in these late lectures. Precisely the most disappointing lecture in the series, Foucault knows it is the least good. He says, forgive these superficial surveys. They are notes for possible work. Hoping for continuity is about the continuity of the cynics into modernity and terrorism. That is really a total loss. But, and he knows it. He knows it. But that's that continuity step. So there's the origin, there's that. But Said is most interested in, I quote, exploring the experience of late style that involves a non-harmonious, non-serene tension, and above all, a sort of deliberately unproductive productiveness going against. Although Foucault celebrates Socrates as the, this is me, as the master of harmonies and pays his dues like that, I got to teach Socrates, and he forgets, you see, I'm a reader of Yeats. I mean, Yeats so much focused on giving time and place and undermining things like upon the brimming water among the stones are 9 and 50 swans. So he's obviously wrong, the poet, when he says, lover by lover they're flying, 9 and 50. And then at another point he says, 20 minutes more or less I was blessed and could bless. You can't be blessed 20 minutes more or less. You can't do that. So to an extent here what Foucault ignores is that in the Platonic texts that he reads, Socrates is mentioned as having the Dorian harmony. Many proper names are given, the Ionic, the this, the that. No, Socrates has the Dorian. That's not the master of harmonies, but Foucault has to see Socrates as such, celebrating Socrates as the master of harmonies, and the pays his dues, shows some of his contrariness in reading the classical philosophical tradition as clearly suggesting that there can be no ethical differentiation in democracy. Incidentally, I can turn Foucault, this is what I was going to, it's referring to, I can turn Foucault around here and put him with Gramsci, which he would obviously have disliked very much, put him with Gramsci and Fanon, and humbly, with my own practice, very humbly, by suggesting that this calls for sustained work for individual education, for collectivization, that his argument can be made to take on board. See, gnosiology, epistemology, this is that moment of the petit derridiste. But surely it is in the celebration of the philosophy of the cynic that the absence of serenity and the deliberately unproductive productiveness going against comes into play, precisely after his apology for the effort to show continuity into and through terrorism. Foucault had always said that he did not mention Heidegger because Heidegger was so important to him. He relates here in this series of lectures the neglect of, I quote, the question of the philosophical life to Heidegger's project, without naming him, of suggesting that the question of being, I quote, the question of being has been what Western philosophy has forgotten, and that this forgetting is what made metaphysics possible, end of quote. There is indeed a moment of serenity in quoting, and from this he goes into what the cynics represent. The cynics have been neglected, not forgotten. Okay, that is his word. And Protestantism makes Christianity modern, and scientific ways of doing philosophy has also neglected the cynics. Spinoza, indeed, is the last great other kind of philosopher. I don't know what Balibar would say to that. He's a Spinoza specialist. But anyway, so there is indeed a moment of serenity in quoting Epictetus' formula for the cynic. The cynic ought to be free from distraction, wholly devoted to the service of God, free to go about among men. Alas, that one is singular. I looked very carefully at the Epictetus passage. I wanted it to be plural. Wholly devoted to the service of God, free to go about among men, not tied down by the private duties of men, nor involved in relationships which he cannot violate, and still maintain his role as a good and excellent man. But it is the last characteristic of the cynical program that he particularly celebrates in the first hour of the lecture on the 14th of March, 1984. This figures a summary of what he has said so far. In that lecture, he gives a summary. First, the political bravery, he says, of truth-telling, I quote, it's involved opposing the courage of truth-telling to an opinion, an error. And then, I quote, in the case of Socratic irony, by contrast, and in the second stage, it involves introducing a certain form of truth into a knowledge that men do not know they know, a form of truth which will lead them to take care of themselves. That's Socrates. This is where one risks one's life by the very way in which one lives. When he comes to the, after political bravery and Socratic irony, we have, I quote, we have, if you like, cynic scandal. That's the word, scandal. This is where one risks, I quote, one risks one's life by the way in which one lives. In all the meanings of the words, one exposes one's life. Today, through the modality of Protestantism and the scientific study of philosophy, the old grand idea that philosophical life must be an other kind of life has been forgotten. And he contrasts the Platonic other kind of life and the cynical other kind of life. Other, other. Je est un autre. I didn't want to say that, but why not? This is where we are now, if he wants it in modernity, this is where we are now with Parisia, living a life to risk death. Now, the cynics say, I quote, can there be anything bad in what nature wills and in what she has placed in us? So there are other places where Foucault says this, the very end, 314, the last words, page 340. Now again, he starts telling anecdotes as reported by the ancients. He speaks of Heraclitus, who was supposed to have gone, I quote, among the artisans and sat and warmed himself at the baker's oven, saying to those who were astonished and indignant, but the gods are also here. In the original Aristotle text, and is given in a footnote here, the word can also be dung heap or latrine. That's where Heraclitus was sitting. That's why they hesitated in entering. Foucault writes that Diogenes chose to go to Corinth so often because it was a big public town where one could live in public and meet sailors, travelers, and people from all over the world on the street corners and in the temples. It was under this gaze that Diogenes chose to live. And finally, he dies in a gymnasium at the gates of Corinth, wrapped in his cloak like a sleeping beggar. And the cynic, I quote again, must actively seek dishonor, adoxia, which could not be given positive value in a society in which relations of honor were so important, where glory, a good reputation, and the record one leaves in men's memory was one of the desired forms of afterlife, end of quote. Yet, Foucault never exercises a deliberate intentionalism here. It is nowhere more than this is how they thought. This figuring of a kind of life which Foucault is describing as he is waiting to die. The 1983-84, these are very important dates in the development of the understanding of what HIV was. So that's a very important time. He doesn't know, and yet he does know, right? And somehow it is a scandal. We haven't mentioned Edward, and we haven't also ever mentioned the fact that this man was sitting in this place. The only effect, it is nowhere, so Foucault never exercises a deliberate intentionalism here. This is not what Foucault is intending. It is nowhere more than this is how they thought. The only, quote, effect of what he's teaching is his technique of teaching now through narrative as ethical instantiation rather than argument. Stories, same stories not always read the same way. This impatience I will describe in Michael Wood's delicate words, and I quote, death does sometimes wait for us. And I would really like to dedicate these words to Arvind, to Srinivas Aravamudan. At 54, he died yesterday. Wonderful man, wonderful friend. Death does sometimes wait for us. The quality of time alters then, like a change in the light, because the present is so thoroughly shadowed by other seasons. The revived or receding past, the continuity, the newly unmeasurable future, and how much he talks about that. The unimaginable time beyond time. End of quote. This is a text without women. The only mentions, all feminists have tried to find stuff in Foucault, etc. I'm not there. The only mentions of women are on page 171. Epictetus says, I quote, that the cynic cannot have a family because ultimately humankind is his family. Man, he has fathered all humanity, all men are his sons, all women his daughters. No, I'm not a daughter of a cynic. And then and on page 299, where Hector asks Andromache to go home and weave, I can live with this. I have indeed taught many times Herculine Barbin, and so I know what Foucault can do when he wants to. Okay, so as I say, this is a staging, this is a figuring, and that's how I will read it. In these lectures in the late style, Foucault has perhaps undone, since he doesn't openly speak his desire, the impudent complaint that I made against him in 1981 in Can the Subaltern Speak, that he doesn't walk what he talks. Many of us know he can't step out of Europe. I had wanted to end by citing the very beginning of my piece, Foucault and Najibullah, because Pakistani feminists have found this helpful and they've given me this courage. Then I went back to the book where it is, a chapter, and I saw that I had so changed it from the first time I saw the picture of Najibullah hanging from the lamppost, the last communist head of Afghanistan, and people looking, and compared it to Discipline and Punish and the scene that opens. I had so changed it that integrating it would be very hard. Perhaps at a certain point in time, I would integrate that page to all of this. Thank you for your patience, and thank you very much.
All right, so the three presentations, all extremely insightful and provocative, take us in a number of different directions, raise a host of questions for our discussion, and what I'd like to try and do is harness the discussion a bit by extracting a few questions, three in particular. Now, it's somewhat fitting that we would come back in our last session of Foucault 13-13 to the question of obedient and disobedient truths. To the question of the possibility of these two different regimes of truth, which Frédéric Roux, with which he opened our session. Now, it's fitting because these 13 years of lectures have taken us through a series of analyses of truth in its different forms, starting with its juridical forms, the ordeal, the inquiry, leading to the examination and the study of the prisons, then moving to its historical forms, as you will recall, in the society must be defended, and then on to its economic forms, with the idea in the birth of biopolitics that the market becomes the measure of truth, and then finally in its various subjective forms, where we are here in these final years, addressing the issue of truthful speech, truth-telling, as a form of the care of the self, intended to do work, to have effects on others and on ourselves. To have effects, to govern self and others, the very title of this book, of these lectures, rather. These exercises on the self, these forms of what Gayatri Spivak mentioned in her writings on the blog of the possibilities of autocritique here, have effects. They are intended to have effects, to change the views of others, of the tyrant, and to have effects on our own ethical selves. Now, this raises the first question in relationship both to Frédéric Roux's typology and also to Gayatri Spivak's challenge to the epistemological dimensions of these typologies, which is, should we think of these as different regimes of truth, or as truth claims, each of which push in different directions? In other words, are these qualitatively or ontologically or substantively different regimes, or is it that the truth claims in general can be deployed towards different ends? And that notion of being deployed toward different ends, I think, is captured somewhat by Gayatri Spivak's idea of staged performances of figures of truth, right? Now, This question actually brings me back to the conversation we were having last Sunday, which was a workshop on Foucault's prison militancy in the early 1970s and the legacy of the Groupe d'Information sur les Prisons, and to a particular difficulty that we encountered there with the notion of the intolérable. Because like these truths, like these different categorized truths, the notion of intolérable also, or of the intolerable, also comes in two very different, even opposed versions in Foucault's work. On the one hand, there's the notion of the intolérable from the early 1970s and the militant activism of the Groupe d'Information sur les Prisons. On this meaning, the intolerable is what we can no longer accept. It's over-incarceration, it's the terrible conditions of confinement, it's solitary confinement, it's suicide in the prisons, it's the racism and the political assassination of George Jackson. Now, this would lead members of the JIP to conduct their enquête intolérance, right, on that notion of the intolerable, inquiries into those intolerable conditions, four of which were published ultimately by Gallimard. Now, here the intolerable is an epistemic condition that to a certain extent of resistance, that to a certain extent is associated with a particular political method, I would think, or praxis at the time of the genealogical analysis of power. Now, on the other hand, though, in these 1984 lectures, you'll notice that the notion of intolérable comes back into play, but it takes on a completely different guise. Here, it's the cynics who themselves are intolerable, but intolerable to the ordinary citizen, right? Cynic truth-telling, on Foucault's reading, is associated with a distinct type of intolerable insolence. The cynics push their frank speech to the extreme, to the point where their frankness becomes intolerably insolent. And so on page 165 of the English edition, on page 153 of the French edition, you hear this very clearly. In cynic practice, Foucault says, in cynic practice, the requirement of an extremely distinctive form of life with very characteristic, well-defined rules, conditions, or modes is strongly connected to the principle of truth-telling without shame or fear, of unrestricted and courageous truth-telling, of truth-telling which pushes its courage and boldness to the point that it becomes intolerable insolence. So here, too, we see a notion reappear, the notion of the intolerable, but this time it's the practice of resistance that is intolerable, really. It's the cynics' practices. And so the question that arises in both this context, but also in the context of two possible regimes of truth, is whether we're dealing with different truths qualitatively or simply different deployments of truth, something maybe more along the line of figures of truth, stage performances. And here I think of expert opinion. In law, of course, we're always faced with experts on both sides of legal disputes. Often experts who are taking some risk. There are those experts who are justifying domination and those who resist it. In most political debates too, there are expert truths on both sides. So, for example, but for the expert statistical interventions of our colleague at the law school, Jeffrey Fagan, whose econometric analyses of New York stop and frisks revealed their racial biases and their doubtful constitutionality, the resistance to stop and frisk would not have succeeded as well, may not have succeeded. Now, and that expertise, of course, was deployed in the way it was deployed, was taking risks. And so the expert there was taking risks in personal costs in relations to others and to legitimacy, et cetera. And of course, we see the similar thing on statistical work on broken windows policing or order maintenance policing. Without that, there would be much less resistance today to those racially discriminatory policies. And so we see experts doing linear regression models at some risk to challenge the evidence for order maintenance or econometric equations to to show the inefficiency of profiling or going into the historical archives to demonstrate the illusion of free markets or something like that. In all of those endeavors, I take it, expert truth is a form of resistance, not subordination. Inversely, ethical truth, for instance, ethical truth of many pro-lifers or possibly also pro-choice, work in favor or in resistance to subordination. The religious ethical truths of many Christians today in North Carolina, which do operate on the self and are operating in favor of subordination of transgender persons. So these are battles that are being fought in the domain as well of the ethical self. Okay, so one question for us, I think, is whether we're dealing with different truth domains, or is it that similar type of truth claims are being deployed differently? Now, let me quickly pose the other two questions more rapidly to start moving to the discussion. Bashir Diagne raised an important question about the relationship between the philosophical life, the force of living, the practice of philosophy, and facing death, or the reach of death. And of course, in these lectures, we get this strong, clear articulation of philosophy as a way of living, and not just being smart on questions, as Bashir was suggesting, rejecting the idea that philosophy is a negation of life, rejecting the Nietzschean notion that the sacrifice of the rooster was about being cured of life. Now, the question here, I think, is how should we, in our philosophical practices, relate to true life / death? And that raises a question to me of what it might mean to think about true death, right? I mean, we speak a lot about true life in these lectures, but what does it mean to talk about true death? And then third, picking up on some of the writings of Gayatri Spivak on the blog in particular, and the brilliant intervention raising the question about and we've touched on it a little bit, but the question of the possibility of an autocritique in these lectures. Okay, so let me briefly start the discussion of these three questions and put a few additional objects on the table. So first, with regard to the first question about regimes of truth versus deployments of truth, I think it would be interesting to talk a little bit about what's happening right now with these new social movements that are budding in Paris right now, La Nuit Debout. And Nuit Debout, nights standing nights. And so these are actually our colleague Antonio Pelle in Rio, who's been participating virtually, and hopefully he's participating right now, may bring some of this into the conversation as well. François Eval have been keeping me appraised of these recent developments in Paris because they're particularly interesting, particularly close to the Occupy movement. And so it's happening in, I think, mostly in the Place de la République, which has developed an enormous amount of symbolic importance in Paris today. And it's people who are kind of spending the whole night there occupying the place. Of course, you know, there are new regulations in France that don't allow you to assemble in the same way as one used to be able to do that. So these are challenging those ordinances that were put up in the wake of the Paris attacks, setting up for nightly conversation, challenging, and being disobedient. And I think that that would be an interesting place to look at, to see what kind of, whether we typologize the truths or whether we see the way that they're being deployed. Also, there's an interesting question, I think, right there in Nuit Debout about notions of consensus. And many of the challenges, the disobedient challenges there, are about resisting consensus, embracing dissensus in some way. So that would be an interesting thing to think about in this context. Then, on both the questions of the relation to death and to autocritique, I wonder if it would be helpful to turn back to the notion of the aesthetics of existence that Foucault really develops in these 1984 lectures. So by contrast to other domains of inquiry and analysis, metaphysics, ontology of the soul, etc., Foucault unearths here this other tradition, or uncovers or creates this other tradition, one that focuses on the beauty of the life we leave behind. What is it that we leave this world of ours when we depart? How is it? And this is on page 162, principally, of the English edition, where Foucault writes, we should recall that man's way of being, and conducting himself, the aspect his existence reveals to others and to himself, the trace also that this existence may leave and will leave in the memories of others after his death, this way of being, this appearance, this trace, have been the object of his aesthetic concern, right? Yesterday, in our seminar on torture and confessions, which some students are here, we were discussing a brilliant idea that Jesus had about the audience of torture debates as an audience of tragedy. In the course of that conversation, an idea came up, or after that conversation, but something about related to death, and it's this, that perhaps we should lead our lives as if we were on our deathbed. On our deathbed, coming to terms with the things we regret the most. I'm thinking of here, of course, of Supreme Court justices on their deathbeds disavowing the worst decisions that they had ever written. And actually, it's usually the case that towards the end of the life of a Supreme Court justice, they come out and will have some interviews where they say, you know, I wish that opinion, I wish I had never written that one, right? Usually, they're right. But the idea here would be, as an aesthetic of existence, or possibly as just leading our lives as if we were on our deathbed, of course, trying to avoid, by that form of living, that we would have to regret the things that we did. Now, I wonder if that would be a form of autocritique that we could extract from these lectures creatively. So let me conclude, and then we're going to open up the discussion, but quickly because of time, on this theme of autocritique and relationship, there was one other passage that I really think we ought to put on the table, and it's about revolutionary militantism, and it's about on 183 and 184 of the book. And it's just we haven't talked about it yet, but I think we need to put it on the table, because for those who saw a reformist Foucault or even a neoliberal Foucault, I never cease to be amazed at the way in which he returns over and over, obsessively, endlessly, over and over, and here again in these lectures, to the theme of the revolutionary actor, right? That is, every year we address this question. And there's no doubt that he was kind of taken by the revolutionary figure, with revolution, with revolutionary militancy. In these final lectures, he elaborates, drawing on the cynics and on a notion of political militantism that can be drawn from their work. And he writes on page 183, bottom of 183, cynicism, the idea of a mode of life as the eruptive, violent, scandalous manifestation of the truth is and was part of revolutionary practice and of the forms taken by revolutionary movements throughout the 19th century. Now, then he refers to three different styles of militantism, of revolutionary life, and of course this is the third one, and it resonates somewhat with me. This is on page 184, and then the third important way of being militant is militancy as bearing witness by one's life in the form of a style of existence. This style of existence specific to revolutionary militantism and ensuring that one's life bears witness breaks and has to break with the conventions, habits, and values of society. It must manifest directly from its visible form, its constant practice, and its ultimate existence, the concrete possibility and the evident rule of an other life, which is true life. Here again, right at the center of the experience of the life of revolutionary militantism, we find the theme so fundamental at the same time, so enigmatic and interesting of the true life, of that problem of the true life which was already raised by Socrates and which I do not think has ceased to run through all Western thought. Okay. Wait, I'm sorry, that was on 184. Yeah. Okay. Now, Foucault argues that this form of militant life resurfaces in the contemporary, though he suggests that, he writes, 186, in the present situation, all forms and styles of life which might have the value of a scandalous manifestation of an unacceptable truth have been banished. And I can't help but read into that discussion a certain embrace of that model. So let me stop there and turn it back to Jesus.
Thank you, Bernard. Thank you very much. So we are a little bit sorry to interrupt your applause, but we, in the interest of the little time we have left, so we are going to do this. We are going to take some ideas, some comments, some questions from you, and then our guests will have another opportunity of speaking about all that for 3 minutes, 4 minutes, or something like that, and then we will go on and take a few minutes to close this series. So please, if you have questions, Alex.
Should I go ahead and start, or you want to take the names?
Alex.
So yes. I want to follow on this, like when you started parting up the different kinds of truth, which ties to Gayatri's commentary that this is simplistic, reducing this kind of thing to three, and connecting it to modes, literary modes in which we could speak truth in the name of an epistemological project that I don't think you came back to, but I was kind of waiting for that. So this is the opportunity. Well, you asked in your Gayatri in your blog post, in the first one, that you did, for us to think this together with Nadia Saavedra and her murder, for speaking the truth about it. How do we think about that today with all these other modes? But also let's relive some of these new forms of like truth telling today that kind of don't fit these old models, like the Panama Papers. What kind of truth speaking is that? It's kind of weird, right? This Panama paper kind of telling the truth. So it's, and we can phenomenologically keep on piling these. So what I want to know is, with Foucault or without Foucault, in what mode, in what genre, can we move forward as a community of academics, researchers, speaking a truth that can go beyond the simplistic models? That's my question.
So, can you introduce yourself?
Please?
Oh, sure, yeah. I'm John Howard from Binghamton University. It's hard to see truth with the cynics. It's hard to know what's true about the cynics. A lot of that goes down the root of their relationship to nature. That is a manifestation of the true life. But the more compelling ways of reading them, I think, are the scandal of truth, which is a disfiguring of truth. And so I think that opening up onto the other life that they make available, rather than the true life, is maybe a pivot point for thinking about that.
My name is Tamer Malad, and I'm a student at the law school here. So my question pertains to the relationship or tension, if any, between paresia and impunity, or its discursive corollary, justice, as administered by the state. So my first, I guess, chain of thought in my questioning is, does justice, when it's countering impunity or limiting, evince, distract, or numb the paresias in his work? So let me explain myself. Justice in the sense where, as it applies a rule of law, which may appear to be ethically justified, but when the judge applies it, has no ethical consideration. He's just trying to apply a holding or a previous set of rules. And so in that sense, can the paresias coexist with the state or state-administered justice? Or is the function of the paresias reduced or eliminated, if not suppressed? And so I think in that sense of, by relying on the state to try to, I suppose, say the truth, but it's not really saying the truth, and I go back to your analogy, professor, with Galileo, are we going back, or is the citizen going back into the state, or un retour dans l'état de minorité, when justice takes over what the paresias may in the past have, I suppose, been able to do? Thank you.
Thank you. Rafael?
Sorry, yes,
Luca, you have something from LST room?
So this is a question from Charlene Bieldy for Professor Kuo, and she asks,
You mentioned ethical truth that transforms our relationship to ourselves and that enables the care of the self or the souci de soi, and the dissident truth that enables paresia or disobedience. And she asks, aren't the two correlated and dependent upon one another? And then the second question is from Xavier Flory, and he asks whether the cynics actually, in Foucault's account, despise hierarchy or merely reverse it in a way that crowns themselves at the top of the hierarchy in terms of the monarch.
Since we don't have more comments now, we can... Oh, Dana, please.
More a question. She was mentioning that she's a literary critic, and you know, we haven't talked a lot about the aesthetic side of Foucault. I don't mean the aesthetics of life, but role of culture, art, representation. I was just, you know, Val now read the sections around 183, 186, where he's talking about revolution, and right after that, the last line, he says something like so-called revolutionary parties, and then goes into a discussion for about four pages of art and 19th century art. And I just was wondering if any had one wanted to say anything about that side of Foucault, you know, which culminates 189 as he ends that lecture. He says, it is especially in art that the most intense forms of a truth-telling are concentrated. So what is the role of the artistic of modernism? And, you know, his examples are Manet, Flaubert. So I just thought, I was just wondering if anybody had thoughts about that particular part of this book.
So perhaps the first round of reactions to some of these questions from our guests, in the order today.
Yes, about what you said. In the first version of my text, I proposed the term of theoretical truth and not expert's truth. And I changed after. And certainly what I propose, it's a reconstruction. It's not a description. When Foucault speaks about what he calls l'intellectuel spécifique, when he speaks about le savoir localisé, he says that we can consider, we can imagine an expert's truth that creates resistance, certainly. But the opposition is between expert truths and our expert discourse and universal discourse, ideological discourse. When I speak in this text, when I mention expert truth, I designate only definitive, established, written knowledge. Truth you have only to learn. And this truth, I think, they can create authority, hierarchies, and subordination. So, yes, I think it's ambiguous. The term of expert's truth is ambiguous, yes. But I have not found other. I have not found other. And yes, the second thing would be my problem now is how can I find the common structuration of obedient truths and of disobedient truth? If we accept to speak of two regimes of truth, the problem is what is the fundamental difference between those two regimes? And I think that the regimes of obedient truth is the regime of truth that creates identity, creates similarity. And disobedient truth is other regimes that creates difference, that creates otherness. And this is, I think, the very opposition for me. And so the problem of how can we, I think the problem is for us, how can we relate the history of truth, of the truth, and the traditional manner is to would be the consider the history of truth is the progressive affirmation, the progressive victory of the truth against the illusion. But in Foucault's perspective, it's other thing. It's the eternal battle between between what I call obedient truths and disobedient truth. I mean a battle between two regimes on truth. And these two regimes on truth are, when I say obedient truth and disobedient truth, I speak of subjective forms of truth because, and this is for me one thing very important. For the first time, the problem of obedience and disobedience is not connected with the problem of the law, but of the truth. It's for me the yes.
May I ask something? Do you mind? Sorry, it's not usual, but I ask you for forgiveness. But it would be perhaps interesting to relocate in this discourse the question of truth, the question of paresthesia, the question of cynicism, etc., etc. Something that it seems to me that Foucault doesn't underscore sufficiently and that we have not underscored sufficiently, which is that paresia is also a rhetorical figure. So paresia and rhetoric also have the same root, which is discourse, no? The res part of the word. So paresia is to say everything, pa from pas, pasapan, and then res, yes, the discourse. So is in a certain way this question of this intimate relationship between paresia and rhetoric something that would change the way in which we talk about the discourse of truth? Would it be important in order to deal with this question of the techniques of truth to talk about this rhetorical technique as well, to the staging, to the conditions in which the res or the ret part comes about? Just a question. We have three words, but I promised. So I have first Rosalind and Anne, but I promised our guests a first reaction. So I it was me who interrupted you. Sorry.
Who's next?
Go,
okay. So two very quick reactions to one to the let me see, scandal of truth rather than true life. It reminded me of a cynic story. Cynics actually, we know them through many little stories rather than presenting arguments, etc. And the story that came to my mind asking about the scandal of truth was the story about Crates and the way in which he got married. It was said that the woman who was to become Crates' wife just saw him so often in the marketplace doing whatever he was doing and going back to her family and saying that she was in love with Crates and she really wanted to marry him. And the father of the woman could not believe what she was saying and made sure that Crates would come to their home and ask his daughter, "You mean this Crates that you want to marry?" And she said yes, and Crates just left his toga fall, came totally naked, and say, "Are we talking about this man?" And the woman said, "Yes." And this is how they got married and went. This idea of the naked truth and the naked nature, the idea that our animality and our nature is the shortest, actually, way. If we are as human beings, a middle between the animal and the angel, maybe instead of trying very hard to go up towards our angelic nature, taking the shortcut of living fully our animal nature would be a way of doing that. I think that would be that kind of story would be answering the question of the scandal of truth. Truth manifested as a scandal, rather. Very quick point also. Parisia and impunity, it made me think of who is the Parisiast, the good Parisiast? We need Parisiast. And given the risks involved in Parisia, impunity could be a way of helping. And I was thinking of the so-called whistleblowers who are granted impunity if they denounce the others, or something more closer to the le fou du roi, the one who by very function and nature is allowed to say with total impunity what is not said. And the good king is the one who needs the fou du roi. So you can be angered by your fou, etc., but it is understood that you are going to do nothing. In my own culture, my Senegalese culture, the child of your aunt is supposed to play that role. It has to be, in my case, my paternal aunt, their children, can tell me anything. And I'm not supposed to get angry. And that's very useful. If I am a king one day, a president would be easier probably nowadays, would be sure I appoint my cousin, that kind of cousin, as my advisor.
Okay, that's three.
Yes, now the problem of Parisia is who has really I'm really trying to do the contemporary thing that you're asking for. I mean, it's you imagine that there are truths that can be told by everyone. You know, we really think of ourselves as the kinds of subjects that Foucault is talking about. I mean, I don't want to. You talk about your Senegalese culture, and you know, I always discourage people at the World Economic Forum when they're from Africa and Asia to talk about their culture. I say, look here, we're sitting here, we went to the Sorbonne, we did this and that. They want us to talk about our cultures. Why? Because they have history, we have cultures. Shush. And this is something that, you know, we should think about. And so from that, but in terms of culture, since you asked the question, I didn't want to bring this up. You know, I'm now engaged in a life and death struggle with my schools there because these people, having been millennially epistemologically damaged, cognitively damaged by ourselves, by the caste Hindus, what they really perceive as truth, I can't teach them, hey, there is one truth and that's the one you ought to speak. On the other hand, he's destroying 30 years of work. And I can see where that truth is coming from. So that's why I was saying that this is not a place where, I mean, Parisia, who can follow that one? I mean, and we are really assuming that, that idea comes from somewhere else. We are assuming that ethical truth is somehow individual. Who believes this in the world except for a small group of people? And we are assuming that the revolutionary figures of the 19th century in Europe is really an interest in revolution. European revolutionism, what the hell is that? And to an extent, I mean, Diana Reese is sitting there, you remember that thing in the 18 Brumaire, where, in fact, having said about the Communist Manifesto, please do not, I mean, that's the 1872 preface, Marx and Engels, do not read the stuff about revolution in this thing, because 1848 has happened and 1871 has happened, and we know that that stuff is outdated. Please don't read that. And it's only a historical document. I'm quoting. It's only a historical document. We do not have the right to alter it. Please read it as such. Then after that, he writes, like the proletarian revolution, it's like hic raudus hic salta. That is to say, some mocking a person who had made a false promise that I can jump over the, whatchamacallit, the Straits of Rhodes. And so they said the Palestinian Revolution will have the Verhältnisse and all these situational truths finally telling the, it, there's no revolutionary subject there, right? And this is why Perry Anderson, Etienne Balibar, they think Marx cannot be followed. But then Rosa Luxemburg thought that she had seen such a thing happening in the 1905 whatchamacallit. Huh? But then Rosa Luxemburg knew that she was not completely correct, you know, so that that paresia of being moved by that, that kind of unbelievable kind of one after the other, after the other, after the other, those strikes from beginning in Baku and then going to St. Petersburg and so on, that she had been wrong. Sitting in her jail right after 1917, she writes this thing saying, Comrade Lenin has made these mistakes. So when you look at the details of, and then she's shot and called a whore and dumped into the water. When you look at these kinds of details, and then you get into all these national liberations pretending they're revolutions, and that is completely untrue. So the talk about truth. So it seems to me that you can't take these figures of revolutionisms as Foucault's real coming back. I mean, he does, of course, he belongs to that whole world, the Second International Communism, where they can say socialism is something that has been treated as the cynics have been treated. And I'm glad for that. But I think we have to put them, we have to really situate Foucault to an extent, not forget him, but welcome him as our brother, but not think that he really, when he's talking about parisia and rhetoric, binary opposition, that he's actually telling us something that we can actually do. That's why Jesus's point is very nice. What should we think? And that was in one of my first blogs. Huh? That why is he making this binary opposition, that parisia is not rhetorical, etc. But the thing is that if we make take these binary oppositions, I come back to what I was saying, seriously, then we will reduce Foucault to something, which he's not in these last lectures. I really want to bring, I mean, there are philosophers here and social scientists here, but I think we who deal with fiction, underived fiction, not as an opposite to truth, we can contribute something to this kind of madness about something called truth, which is a singular word, which somehow Socrates can say it's logos, and I'm not teaching you, but logos will teach you, so you will know what you don't know. Eh? So, so to an extent, I would say that I was talking about autocritique right in the beginning because of Tom Flynn. Tom Flynn, who was my colleague, whom I adore, he's a wonderful guy, he's a padre, and he was actually listening to Foucault's talks at that point, when I was at Emory and so was Tom. So I remember I said I haven't read the book yet in that first blog because I just happened to look at Tom's thing and said, oh, Tom is saying that this is not about parisia as political, but this is about a guy saying, look, I will tell the I have to tell the truth about myself even if the shame kills me. But Tom misunderstood. I don't think that's what is here. I think in the cynic's position, there can perhaps be some kind of autocritical thing because it's constantly reversed. In the Socratic position, but we all know that, a wild psychoanalysis, that, you know, you are, the logos will do the trick. There is an of course, Socrates is nothing if not this kind of autocritic, you know? I mean, Lacan would say metonym of psychoanalysis. So to an extent, it seems to me that we have to really think about the word truth a number of times before we just begin to say this is our ideal. Because the world is very big, and Saavedra's killer also thought about certain things as true. You know what I mean? Sunil Lohar and these people, they also think of certain things as true because of what they see all around them. So it's not, I don't think we can just take the Foucauldian subject who resembles us much more than these other kinds of subjects, as just being a subject who can then intentionally really tell the truth and be a hero, and the ethical subject is singular, and so on. That's, I'm sorry, I've spoken a long, long time, and you haven't had the opportunity to ask your wonderful questions.
So actually, we have four wonderful questions, and maybe, so that I know I know there are more, but I registered four, and we need to keep. So we are going to take those four, a very fast, quick last round, and then we will close the session. And these four are Rosalind, Anne, Emily Apter, Reinhold.
Is one of us double?
Four?
Three.
That's three?
Yes.
I said four. Rosalind, Anne, Reinhold, and Emily.
I want to pose a question in the space between the comments, all wonderful comments, but especially to me interesting comments of Federico's and Gatchi's feedback. And there's something about the diagram that you gave us which tempts one, especially if you're an anthropologist, to a certain kind of structural reading. And there's a way in which you make visible what might be described in some context as, you know, discursive or disciplinary orders that are working in the mode of language games by within which normality and transgression function. And one is tempted to read these as sedimentary layers in an archaeological mode that is removed from a language game in which normality and transgression are displaced or supplemented by subordination, resistance, conformism, dissidence, and so forth. And I find that enormously interesting, although it leaves us with the problem of Foucault's own analytic practice is abandonment of a relative abandonment of an archaeological project for a genealogical one. It becomes a problem insofar as that the anti-dialectical position that he adduces leaves a problem. You know, there's not a concept of remainder, there's not a sublation. So we end up always with the rhetoric of, you know, not only but still. It's a laborious moment every time we hear that it's not an epochal transformation argument in the text. And the reason I raised that was because you, in your remarks, asked us to think about the mode of late style here. Which I also came to at the end of my discussion, also in relation to the problematic of age, but not in this kind of careful way. It was really a kind of offhand conclusion. But when we get to the end of this text and Foucault describes for us what it is about cynicism that's so appealing, the aim of this practice, I'm on 315, the aim of this practice of the truth characterizing the cynic life is not just to say and show what the world is in its truth. Its aim, its final aim, is to show that the world will be able to get back to its truth, will be able to transfigure itself and become other in order to get back to what it is in its truth only at the price of a change, a complete alteration, and so forth. And, I mean, this leads me, you know, I'm trying to understand whether your representation of this, whether this position in which an obsession with origins and continuity is inevitable given the problematic Foucault has produced himself in the move from archaeology to genealogy and his refusal of the dialectic. I mean, if you do that, are you stuck with origins and continuity instead of a dialectical model of historical transformation?
Thank you.
I'll try to be brief, though I'm never very good at it, I know. Thank you for these were just wonderful presentations. And I guess I just want to say that these last lectures for me, I think, are among the most seductive of Foucault's lectures. It's the place where you go politically, you know, courage, risk, that's where I'm at. This justifies us to ourselves in a way that makes me equally uncomfortable. Because there's a way in which we haven't questioned at all the kind of risks that someone takes who's an expert. Yeah, so he gets a better job at a less prestigious place. It's not the risk of what it is to defy something and be put to death for it, obviously, right? And there's something about this end part here that it kind of worries me. I've always loved teaching that. Just every year I teach this on Parisia before I got this book before. Just love teaching on it because it feels so good in the academy. But there is a strange way, even with the cynics, that it's still a very intellectual project. it's still, I know it's about, he pays lip service to phronesis. He pays lip service that it's also about making, not just saying. But in fact, so much of this is tethered to speech, to the way we talk, just as you pointed out so well, Jesus. It's so much about performing that speech. And I keep thinking epistemologically how thin it is. That it's not about the sensuous. It's not about, I know, I'm obsessed with it. I have been for, the last 10 years. About sentiment, about affect, about the nonverbal, about the non-conceptual, ways in which disobedience manifests in so many other forms. And I don't mean just going to the art world. Raymond Williams told us, I don't know, that wasn't a put down, and anyway, but that Raymond Williams told us structures of feeling, you really find that emergent political in the art world, in the aesthetic. And there's something else that feels like we're too easily being comforted. And everything that Foucault's taught me is an ethics of discomfort. And I feel kind of annoyed. I don't know what the proof of this truth is either. Does he ever really give us some sense of what would be the proof of what kind of truth the disobedient? I love what you did with that. But I still don't know what the proof would be. Would the proof be my death or the fact that I decided not to die because I have to go on with the political movement? He moves away from the political in this, right? Very, very strongly. He says that's not where it's at. But in a way, that's where it's at for some of us. So I'm concerned that the good Parisiists are still constrained and limited to a certain. And I don't want to romanticize. I'm not going back to romanticizing the peasant and the shoemaker. As Rancière says, all philosophers do. But there is something being occluded here that concerns me.
So much for this. I wish I could have come to all of them. Come at the very end. But I wanted to come back to the petite Derridienne. And this question is, I think, very serious because I don't know if the speakers or it's been raised and you partially responded already, but figure of truth versus the concept. And it's a referendum a bit on a kind of deconstructive politics is this turn to the concept of truth, whether it's disobedient or obedient, is that in a sense reaccrediting or rehabilitating truth as a And where does this leave historically the question of how we do politics now? In other words, you're saying we cannot go back to a concept of truth. We're still we must take seriously the political consequences of the Derridiste, even if it's not an answer. And it strikes me that it articulates a kind of impasse for talking about politics, because one doesn't want to relinquish the concept of truth quand même, but the figure is posed against it. And so it seems to, I'm sure you've discussed this many times, but you're going to, in a sense, to a historical referendum on the moment we're in and the return to Foucault now, and what this kind of squeamishness that people who had Derridian formations would feel towards a concept of truth. And then, of course, the sense of respect for the languages of truth and how that complicates the paradigm. Truth in which language, in which term? We're thinking of philosophie en langue, obviously.
Briefly?
Yes.
Sorry, we are going to be exceeding a little bit our time.
I must say that as the last questioner, I'm tempted to break the spell and thank Bernard and Jesus for the whole thing. But we should do this as But my question is really just a footnote. I really want to hear this discussion, but it's a historical footnote that may have some kind of theoretical philosophical consequences. It has to do with the asides that Foucault makes periodically. We've discussed this before. His apologies, for example, for I can't deal with this in the lecture, I must convene a seminar. Because if we're going to situate, it seems to me the sites, and in the spirit of figuration and staging, the sites of figuration, the rhetorical modes, the sort of the anecdotal mode, and so on. And so just to cut to the chase, because it seemed to me that if Bashir, if you're right about this, because I thought this was a very kind of beautiful explanation and sort of situating of the text vis-a-vis Nietzsche's rejection of the Socratic program, that if this there is in some sense, if Socrates is not just a stalking horse here, that he's in some sense being recuperated as the philosopher of life in some form, perhaps if not exactly the true life, because that's what he says. He says, this is, 163, I have to do this. It's exactly when he says, the problem of the true life would obviously require a whole series of studies, but once more, forgive me for complaining, yet again, it's clear that these things, et cetera, I need to do a seminar. So, at some level, approaches, it seems to me, the Socratic mode more directly than the theater of the lecture. There's many, many sides about the abstraction of the lecture, his distance from his publics and so on. And so I'm curious, historically, first of all, since there were seminars convened, and maybe this is for Frederick, was something else, was the true life in some way theorized, actively, directly? And then, if not in this more speculative mode, what would be the difference between the different theaters of figuration that we've been talking about?
Thank you. Thank you very much. So we are going to take in reverse order just 1 minute from our guests. This is not the end of the conversation. We will have more time downstairs. So perhaps 1 minute before Bernard closes. Okay?
Yes, you're quite right. I wanted to talk about it. There are those moments. Teacherly, okay? I can't say any more about that. I would say very much more. But I would also say that to you that the concept, I didn't say I didn't want a concept. I said there was no concept here. So the concept is in the figure. The figure is in the concept. You want me to be a bit like Derrida. That's how we go. Okay, that's it. One more, which is what to do. Okay, I'll tell you. Plato. There's so much Plato here, and Plato is ta-da-da. And in fact, the translators of Plato in the Loeb classical tradition, classical edition, and that W.J. Lamb, he says some of the things Foucault says. That is really sad, but at any rate, he's a horrible kind of reactionary Englishman. But at any rate, you want me to cite Derrida? Derrida says a fantastic thing in Rogues, which says, since we can't get away from Plato, we must now echo Plato, like echo the figure, capital E, right? That is to say, she had a subjectivity, an intention, but because she had been punished, therefore she was obliged to give back in just by repeating, but they made a certain kind of sense, but not the sense of what Narcissus was saying, and so on. I can't go on any further, but if you wanted really to know what to do with all this Platonic tradition, I would sit down with you and say, that's it.
Well, a very quick minute, just to say how much I agree with everything that has been said. I agree with your meditation about the form taken by these lectures and his constant way of hinting at what his own discourse could be if he were in a seminar. And you end up thinking in terms of, some kind of esoteric teaching versus an exoteric teaching, the fact that the whole theater of the lecture du Collège de France actually, it's a constraint for what you are saying, with any kind of interruptions. I was very interested in the fact that he was interrupted at one point by music coming from I don't know where. And he says, yeah. Yes. He say, I hope at least it was Michael Jackson. So, and I was trying to think, okay, what did Michael Jackson, you know, produce at that time in 84? Yeah. So, and yes, the, and I think that the what he does with the with Phaedo, Crito, and the and Apology, this kind of very close reading where he mentioned the usual way of quoting Plato's work, Saint-Quinsbe, and stuff like that, is probably what he would have loved to do in a seminar where you are not supposed to have a beginning, a middle, and an end. And you give more chance for anything to come up. And that you had not exactly planned the way it was. But we will just be guessing and somehow reconstructing what the seminar might have been from where exactly he interrupts himself and say, this is the point where I would have needed a seminar. So, and you read that point, that kind of ligne de fuite from what you know from him, from what he had written before. I think that's the only way of proceeding.
Thank you,
Frédéric. Well, one thing I think we can now make the distinction between Platonism and Plato, and I think this is the distinction between a discourse of truth, the l'institutionnalisation de la vérité, and the truth telling, la parole, and I think there is. When I make this distinction between two regimes of truth, there is this first distinction between Platonism and Plato. And it's, yes, it's only that.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
So now okay. All right. So just a few concluding remarks, maybe, not only to today, but to the seminar. With regard to the conversation that was going on here and Gayatri, I don't need to fool ourselves into thinking that Foucault thought that there was necessarily that much courage in acts that he was engaged in, right? And there's this nice passage on page 24 where he says, everybody knows, and I know first of all, that you do not need courage to teach. Right. So, I mean, right. So I don't think that, you know, we're not, you know, so we don't need to. No. But I do think that in this model of the cynic militant life, there was something about yes. the model of struggle, the model of conflict, of battle that we had seen in the early 1970s. And that was so important in the 1970s with the Jeep, but also with the in la société punitive, non, il faut défendre la société aussi. I mean, there was just this model of battle and civil war that was there and that we see again with the cynics. And we see it, I think, on page 283, where he says, you know, we can also say that the cynics reverse and inverse the theme of sovereign life by dramatizing it in the form of what could be called the militant life, the life of battle and struggle against and for self, against and for others. And you can hear the resonances of the, you can hear the grondement de la bataille right there, right? In the cynics, but in any event, but we're going to continue this conversation downstairs over some wine. The lectures at the Collège de France were abruptly interrupted by Foucault's sudden death in 1984, and so we too have decided to abruptly interrupt our seminars here without a kind of final retrospective session. But on these lectures themselves. Now, in several passages in these lectures in 1984, Foucault had mentioned where he planned to go the following year. There's a mention of that on page 316 of The Courage of Truth, where he says, maybe I will try to explore these themes a little next year, but I cannot guarantee it. I confess that I still don't know and have not yet decided. Maybe I will try to pursue this history of the arts of living, of philosophy as form of life, of asceticism in its relationship to the truth, precisely after ancient philosophy in Christianity. And he also had discussed earlier in the lectures, early on, that he wanted to return also to themes of the contemporary, actually. And so he'd indicated there early on that what he had hoped to, quote, return after this several years long Greco-Roman trip, as we were talking about last time, to some contemporary problems, and those contemporary problems being the analysis of certain practices and institutions in modern society. And this gesture towards more contemporary problems highlights, I think, for me, one of the central contributions, ultimately, of this last set of lectures and also of the first section of Volume 2 of the History of Sexuality, the Modification, where he makes plain that the work on subjectivity that he was doing here and on the desiring subject has to be folded back onto the earlier work on knowledge and on power. Right, and the task, ultimately, which he sets out and repeats in here, is to, in his words, study the relations between truth, power, and subject without ever reducing each of them to the others. Right. In any event, as you know, there were no lectures the following year. Foucault died on June 25th, 1984. But our seminar will continue. And what we will try to explore a little next year, although those promises are always a little bit fraught, but we are where we are headed next year is to explore some of these strands of these interpretations of Nietzsche that we've come across this year and that Bashir was talking about specifically in his presentations, the engagement with Nietzsche in these in the 71 lectures through the 1984 lectures, but not just that, but of course there's also Deleuze's Nietzsche, right, which Bashir was talking about earlier, and there's Arendt's Nietzsche at the end of her life in The Life of the Mind, Volume 2, Willing, and there's Edward Said's Nietzsche, and there are many other Nietzsches, and there's Derrida's Nietzsche. There is Derrida's Nietzsche, there's Watsuji Tetsuro's Nietzsche, there's José Carlos Mariátegui's Nietzsche, there's Shankar Ramachandra Rajwade's Nietzsche, and so we will be returning, Jesus and I, and hopefully all of you as well, here to the Casa or to the Maison Française or to the Hyman Center, perhaps the Institute of Advanced Studies, whatever, but to explore post-Nietzsche critique 1313 or Nietzscheans 1313 or critiques with Nietzsche. 1313. So, with deep gratitude to all of the participants in this seminar and to our participants this evening and to everyone who made this possible and to my indispensable and brilliant friend and colleague Jesus Velasco, without whom this whole apparatus would not exist, I want to say farewell to Foucault 1313, welcome to Nietzscheans 1313. And there are books outside to buy. There's wine downstairs to drink. So thank you very much. Thank you.